the V&A has one of the finest and most comprehensive collections of European jewellery in the world. We span from the ancient world to the present day, and so it's roughly 3,000 years of history told through 3,500 pieces of jewellery. We have medieval love jewels. We have pendants from the court of Queen Elizabeth I adorned with her miniature. Diamonds that belong to Catherine the Great. Emeralds given by Napoleon to his adopted daughter. Through to an extraordinary array of contemporary jewels by international artist craftsmen.
Introducing new materials such as titanium, paper and acrylic.
When you step into the gallery, one of the first things probably to catch your eye would be the Townsend collection of jewels, this magnificent spiral of rings. They were bequeathed to the V&A in 1869 by the Reverend Chauncey Hare Townsend. And he was a great friend of Charles Dickens, who dedicated Great Expectations to him. It's a magnificent collection which really shows the intrinsic beauty of coloured stones. It's arranged according to hardness, so you start in the centre with diamonds, but not just white diamonds. You get yellow, blue, green, red, black, and I think it's marvellous for showing the variety within coloured stones. The Jewellery Gallery is one of the best loved spaces within the V&A. It was redisplayed in 2008 thanks to the generosity of William and Judith Bollinger. And since then, we have welcomed over 3 million visitors to the gallery.
I'm a costume designer, primarily for film, and I would say I'm quite versatile. I design superheroes for the Marvel films, and I've designed big period costume dramas like Elizabeth and Golden Age. Jewellery is amazingly important, and you have to take it on board very early on because it can be a huge part of your budget. You need to decide how, where you're going to spend your money in order to have the visual essence that you want. The starting point for any period film is obviously historical. I research the history, I look at all kinds of portraits, paintings, written reference. The gallery at the V&A is incredibly important. Obviously I can research through photographs, archive, internet, books, but to actually see pieces, to understand the beauty, the scale, how the jewels work, the lighting, to see pieces here is invaluable. When I look in this gallery, I'm struck by the beauty, the craftsmanship, and deep envy. I would love to wear some of it. In this gallery, my eye was drawn to the set of peridots. They're beautiful, they sparkle, and they have an amazing story. The set was given by the Prince Regent, George IV, to either Lucy or Charlotte Coates, who were two sisters. And these two sisters were the jailers for Princess Charlotte. The Prince Regent wanted her guarded to make sure she didn't run off and have any more affairs before he could secure her wedding. She then married Prince Leopold, and the jewels were given by Prince Regent to the sisters to be worn at the wedding. I think the jailers, I think it was more like house arrest, and it has been written that one would sleep in her bedroom with her and one would sleep outside the door. Princess Charlotte called them Old Famine and Their Consequences. That was the name she called the two nieces and their aunt. Elizabeth, the Prince Regent's sister, wrote a note when the jewels were delivered, and they were sent in this amazing case along with this letter. And the letter reads, "My dear Miss Coates, I write in great haste by command of the Prince Regent to beg you to accept the set of chrysolites which I send you with this note. He hopes you will wear it at the wedding as proof of his regard. I fear I have not said half enough to your sister, but they are all talking so hard I scarcely know what I am saying." Dated April 30th, 1816. If you imagine the jewels being worn at the wedding, court dress of the period for a woman was white or off-white silk, and the full set would be worn because that was de rigueur at court for that period. The jewels are an amazing colour. The green of the peridots is very clear, very bright. In candlelight, with the white dress, blonde lace, they would have looked amazing.
One of my favourite objects in the gallery is ruby and diamond spray, which is set in silver and gold and was made for Catherine the Great. when we look at them, you can really see how Catherine the Great would have dressed. A contemporary wrote at the time about the dazzling effect that she created with her jewellery, and he wrote, "The profusion of precious gems leaves the pomp of other European courts behind." I was drawn to this object, Lady Mountbatten's bandeau, because it is a definitive Art Deco bandeau. It's a beautiful creeper of carved fruits and leaves and sapphires, rubies and emeralds, and set in platinum and diamonds. Cartier designed this Tutti Frutti. It was very much inspired by the massive amount of work they were doing resetting Maharaja's jewels. And in turn, when the Maharajas came over to Paris, their European customers were very taken by their style and jewels and asked Cartier to make their jewels with a more Indian influence. So this is a perfect fusion of East and West. And also we can see that Lady Mountbatten would have had great fun with it. Apart from wearing it across her forehead, she would have taken it apart because it actually can be split into two bracelets. She was photographed with her new baby daughter wearing the bracelets with the thicker one on top and the slimmer one below. Lady Mountbatten was one of the best dressed women in the world. So she would have had this smart new Eton crop, so you can imagine how dazzling the bandeau would have looked.
The piece I have in the V&A is this cuff, very figurative and very colourful in a sort of a subdued way. It's made of titanium, and titanium's a metal that, you know, it's not new to jewellery, but it's new to jewellery in this very, very figurative way. I think you can probably just pick up, there's a massive amount of detail in this Japanese fighting fish, which is what it's depicting. And I think that's probably the reason actually why the V&A chose it as a piece of significance, was because it is a very, very difficult material. And it's set with blue sapphires, black sapphires, white diamonds, so it's got all the preciousness that you would expect in a piece of fine jewellery. With a piece like this, similar to anything that we make, we'll start with a sketch. In this particular case, the sketch got taken to something that starts to be more like a piece of artwork. Then it gets carved in wax. Now that wax then is taken and cast, and because titanium doesn't want to move, it doesn't flow through a mould the same way as gold does. So you've got to basically carve it and then chop it up. So this was chopped up into about 8 pieces. They're all individually cast and then assembled. And then from there, it's really a process of making it function as a piece of jewellery. So this, you know, this has a clasp. The final thing is putting in the gemstones. And that, to me, is all important, because it gives it a real preciousness and a bit of sparkle and life. I'm very proud to have a piece in the V&A. I think it's, you know, the V&A means a lot to everybody, and this is an amazing department. It's curated so fantastically, you know, and I love to come here myself. You always discover something new. And I think that's probably, you know, that equates to jewellery itself, and the jewellery that I make is that there's always something to discover. It's not that when you first look at it, you don't see everything. And I think that's definitely the case in this room. You could probably come 100 times and see something new.